Good morning.
Good morning.
Why don't you stand to your feet this morning? Little birdie just told me that Roy Liljegren robbed the cradle about 54 years ago. Married a two-year-old. happy anniversary, guys. Hey, glad to have you here today, and we're going to have a wonderful time. Want to remind you of a couple things. This Friday, we have Christmas Eve services at 5 and 7 p.m. They're going to be great. You want to be here. And then next Sunday, the next two Sundays, in fact, we're having regular service schedules just like normal. We're not doing any combining or anything like that. So we will have Connect next Sunday here at 10:30. Let's have a word of prayer and get started. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you, God, for the privilege of being in your house today. And we give you all the glory and all the praise in your precious name. Amen. Sing with me this morning. Come on, put your hands together.
One day walk on water,
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, man.
Christmas is about a love so miraculous, so glorious, so holy, so divine, a love, that could only come from heaven. Advent is a time to open our hearts to accept the gift of a love so boundless, so amazing that we have no words to describe it. We can only accept it as the greatest gift of our Heavenly Father. The Mighty One has done great things. Holy is God's name. The light of the world is coming. And today we will light the fourth candle of Advent, the candle of love. 1 John 4:18 tells us, there is no fear in love, for perfect love casts out fear. Today the flame of this candle reminds us of the love that came to this world when Jesus was born, and of his presence with us. Jesus said, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Remain in my love.
We see the light of God shining over the land.
God's mercy endures from generation to generation for those who love him.
We will open our hearts that love may have a place to dwell.
Light a fourth candle in anticipation of the wondrous birth. Holy light ignites in the sky. Shepherds shake and angels sing. Their light is a beacon of hope. Their presence is a message of mercy. Their words write a love letter from our holy God. God has graced the world with the Christ.
Heart of love lights the way. Turning the world around to man's promise that we love because God first loved us.
Please pray with me. Teach us to love, O Lord. May we always remember to put you first, that we may know your love and show it in our lives. As we prepare for our celebration of Jesus' birth, fill our hearts with love for the world, that all may know your love, and the one whom you have sent, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you so much, Bill and Sherry. Great job. Hey, you know, a lot of exciting things are coming up. Here's what's happening at Kimberly City and Day Methodist Church.
Okay, then. All the way through that, I'm, wait, what? No, wait, what? What is that all about? What are they doing? But the part I liked best was the sheep. Yeah. Mostly because in a talk today, we talk about the people who follow Christ being referred to as sheep in the Bible and how that applies. So we're going to get there in just a minute. Who came up with that video, by the way? I'm still kind of, it was just there. Okay. So this is the fourth Sunday of Advent, guys, and we're going to just do this. All right. How many Sundays are there in Advent, by the way? There are four. So that means today would be fourth and the last Sunday in Advent. So the next thing going on after the fourth Sunday in Advent, if we're following our calendar, would be what? Christmas Eve, right? Especially here, 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock here. We got two services. I hope you guys come to that. It's really going to be a blast and a good way to celebrate. Bring your family, bring your friends. We'll have a good service. They're not going to be long services, under an hour each, I think. But one at 5, one at 7. And there's a slight difference between the two services. Generally the same, except if you want to see Santa Claus, you better come to 5 o'clock. That's all I can say. But there's something even more special if you come to the 7. So take your pick. So you might want to do both, for all I know. But this is the fourth Sunday in Advent. And Mike, as we have been defining words according to the fashion of Lemony Snicket, we would say Advent here is a word that means, and we would describe what the word means. You guys remember this, right? What does Advent mean again? It is a word that means coming, how about arrival? Okay, so if we're saying Advent is anticipating the arrival of the Messiah or Jesus, somebody would respond with, no, wait, he already came in case you guys haven't noticed. How would we respond to that except but to say, well, we are remembering and commemorating the arrival or advent of the Lord. We could even add to that that Christ will come again. And not only are we remembering and commemorating his arrival, but we are anticipating his return or second advent. We could say that as well, right? But we're going to get away from the theology, and we're going to jump right in on this. My justification for the series that we're on right now, which I like to talk about, is simply this. Every single year, I hear tons of people saying, Christmas is just way too complicated and way too commercial. We need to get back to the real meaning of Christmas. We need to simplify it again. So I'm doing a series called Simple Christmas. And being a simple guy, that's fairly easy for me to accomplish. It fits pretty well. And so this is the fourth part of that. And this week, I'm talking about Christ's gifts to us. Now, there's a lot of directions that could go. I have chosen to be guided by one particular passage of Scripture in looking at the gifts that Christ offers to us. And I'll try to explain why I came to that Scripture. When the Magi, or the kings, as we might call them, you know, we three kings, arrived in Israel looking for the Messiah, they said, where is he that is born King of the Jews, right? We've seen his star from the east and we've come to worship him. And naturally, they being royalty checked in at the royal palace of Herod. Okay, that's what you do. Traveling royalty, you don't just bypass the local king, you know. You check in there. Told him why they were there. And he says, well, when you find him, let me know so I can go worship him too. You got that right. But then what did he do? He called for his scholars, who were experts in the Scripture, and said, hey, this new king, this Messiah, are there prophecies about in the Scriptures written about his birth? And where is he supposed to be born? I'm just wondering. And his scholars said, well, Micah the prophet said Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. And that is the Scripture I want to go to today, is chapter 5, starting with verse 2. It reads like this, but you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come one for me who will be ruler over Israel. Now, this is a reference to the birth of Christ, not only stating that he would be born, but giving the location. And that is what the scholars came back to Herod with, was in the little town of Bethlehem. Let's go into verse 4. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth. And he will be our peace when the Assyrians invade our land and march through our fortresses. We will raise against them 7 shepherds, even 8 commanders. But Micah is not only describing the Messiah's arrival, his coming, his birth, but he's telling where that will happen. But if you focus on that, you miss probably the weightier part of his message, which is describing what this Messiah would be doing for his followers, for the people of God. And I've just picked out a couple of those that I want to focus in on today. And naturally, verse 4 said he will stand and shepherd the strength of the Lord. So I want to talk about how he gives you strength. That is one of the things that we learn about the Messiah, and that as we become a follower of Christ, we find out about the strength that he gives us. We tend to not think of ourselves as sheep. We tend to not even like that comparison very well. We prefer to think of ourselves as self-reliant, sturdy, dependable, strong. But when something happens that robs us of our sense of strength, oftentimes that takes us to a place where we learn that we have to rely on God's strength, and because it's in our weakness that God's strength becomes real. I'm thinking of a man named Bob Weiland. back in the late 1960s, he was just got out of high school, was going to go to college, and was a great baseball player. His dream was to play professional baseball. But like many others, and some of you might recognize this, he received a letter in the mail that started with something like this: "Congratulations, your friends and neighbors have selected you." And that's how these draft letters begin, believe it or not. One of my uncles got that. I wasn't quite that age. One of my uncles got one, and he said, "Nope, I don't have any friends and neighbors who would do that to me." I'm not believing this. Which friends and neighbors did you talk to anyway? Bob Weiland was selected by his friends and neighbors to go into the United States Army. He was drafted. He did a tour in Vietnam. And as it turns out, his unit ended up in combat toward the end of his stay there. He made an effort to rescue a fellow member of his unit who was pinned down in a bad situation there. And in that effort, he lost both legs and came home with no legs. And of course, the dream of playing professional baseball was done then. There was no way that could happen. But what was really interesting about this is people expected him to be pretty bitter about that, to be shaken, lose his faith. His response was, "Guys, I lost my legs, not my heart." And he went on to explain when they talked to him about it. But just for the record, he started walking on his hands. I mean, if you don't have any legs, what do? You can be helpless. You can use your hands, walk with your hands. So he completed a three-year walk across America on his hands. He participated in the race across America on a custom-made bicycle and in the bicycle portion of the Hawaii Ironman triathlon. The guy at that time could bench press over 500 pounds. How does he do it? That's the question he was asked on several occasions. And he said, "Here's what happened. When I got back and I was injured and lost my legs, I was pretty shaken up, and it bothered me that my dream to play baseball was just completely gone forever. But I looked in the Bible and it said, 'Cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you.' And he said, 'I decided I'm going to do that. I'm just going to cast all my cares on Jesus Christ and trust him for the outcome in that.' And he said, 'Through that, I learned that it's in my weakness that God's strength comes out. Not where I'm strong, but where I'm weak, that God can be strong.'" And he just simply said, in his own words, "I'm just going to do the best I can to apply God's word to my life because I've learned that it's true and it works." And this was his lesson from that. But basically, like so many of us, he was strong. He felt self-reliant. He felt capable until something happened to change that. And then suddenly he found himself needing a source of strength that wasn't vulnerable in the same way. And it turned out that Jesus Christ was strong in his weakness. Now, most of us are a lot like this guy. We tend to think of ourselves as independent, not needing to call on others for help and not needing to rely on other people. And then something happens that makes us more vulnerable. I mean, you might have a motorcycle wreck and sprain your wrist really bad or something like that. I don't know anybody who's done that recently, right? Or you could break a leg or break an arm, have an illness or other injury, and suddenly you don't have the use of all of the physical capacity that you've once had. And how do you feel now? It's like, "Oh man, there's so many things I want to do that I can't now. How long is this going to take," right? This is what he went through, and in that he said, "I'd found that where I'm weak is where God reveals his strength in me." And that's what Jesus offers us. He is our strength. Regardless of how strong we think we are, when we learn to rely on him and be vulnerable and let all of our weaknesses be the place where he is strong, That's what comes out. You see, our lives don't have to be characterized by the things that we beat ourselves up over. Every one of us have moments when we will start filtering back through our past, and we'll start replaying events of the past and saying, man, I was so dumb then. How embarrassing. I can't believe I did that. Oh, man, I've always been a fool. And have you ever done that to yourself? Right? No. Other people do that. The point is simply this. We can let those things be what characterize our lives, or simply acknowledge, man, I'm weak. I'm not strong like I thought I was, but I'm going to rely on the strength of Christ. He said he'll be my strength. Therefore, I've got plenty of weakness for him to be strong in. I'm going to accept that and trust God in this case and just own who I am here. There we find the strength that only Christ can offer us. It's what Christmas is about. It means we're not going through life alone. We have one who's with us. Not the victim of circumstances, whatever comes our way, but walking in the strength of Christ. And the second thing is that he gives us security, another gift. You know, just like Bob Weiland that we talked about in his experience in Vietnam, we all tend to want to build a secure life and existence. Most of us like to have a home, like to take some ownership of that, or at least refer to it as our place and make it our place, to have a family there, to feel secure in the income that we have, and that we can keep this place, that we can maintain it, that we're not going to be thrown out in the street next week, we're going to have food to eat, we're going to be able to pay our utilities. All of these kind of things are security for us, and we tend to try to build that ourselves. Many of us, by the time we've reached like my age and most of us here, we've had a few experiences that have rocked that, because so many things come our way and all it takes is a one single word experience to shatter the security we've built. What are some of those words? Cancer walks right in without any forewarning or anything else. And in one word, in an instant, our security is changed. The way we view our future is changed. Our priorities have changed. And our emotional outlook on life is changed then as well. Cancer, divorce, downsizing. The list goes on. COVID-19. You know, quite honestly, any one of these things happen, and suddenly the way we viewed our world and our existence doesn't make sense in the same way anymore. If I could ever point to a time where I could say, man, I didn't see this coming. I had no idea I would ever be living in a time where the whole world is just losing its mind. I would say that over the past year and a half, with everything going on related to COVID. I can honestly say, man, I didn't see this coming. I wasn't prepared for this. I didn't know this was going to happen and it was going to work this way. But guess what? And you've heard me say this before. God didn't one morning look down over the balcony of heaven, see what's happening on earth with COVID and everything else, and say, oh boy, I didn't see that one coming. Now what are we going to do? God never did that. Wasn't caught off guard, wasn't taken by surprise, isn't experiencing anxiety over it. But things are playing out. God knows the end result. And God says he is still in control of the universe. Now, there are things that God allows to happen that aren't necessarily God's perfect will. But God knows about all of this, isn't caught off guard by it. God knew all the things you were going to do long before he ever redeemed you. God knows all about you even before he called you. He took all that into account. And still doesn't violate your free will. And he knows how it's going to turn out. I like the scripture in verse 4 of Micah chapter 5. And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth. Referring again to God's people. See, Jesus offers us that security of just knowing that he is in control. We don't have to have anxiety and deep concerns like that when we know that we're in God's hand. I like the way it's stated in Ezekiel chapter 34. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down, declares the sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak. And again, he refers to his people as sheep and him acting in the role of shepherd there. Says it again in John chapter 10. I love this. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. Again, look at the security that God is offering us. He's saying, I control the universe, but I also hold you in my hand. And there isn't anyone who can pull you from my hand. Security, that's what Jesus Christ offers us. Beautiful gift. That's why he came into the world. We could also say, yeah, this is part of what Christmas is about, isn't it? He offers you a security that the world can't offer. But get this. We're not very comfortable with being compared with sheep. I don't want to be a sheep. I don't want to be thought of as a sheep. Why? Well, I'm not. I'm more independent than that. I'm more self-reliant than that. And I don't need that kind of constant guidance that the sheep do. You see, sheep find no safety in themselves. They can't protect themselves from any enemy. They can't take care of themselves on their own. They need someone taking care of them. They need a shepherd. They're helpless without a shepherd. And when God refers to us as sheep, that's what is coming out there. Where we're weak rather than where we're strong. And the other thing I'd like to mention in the gifts that Christ gives us is, I've used the word serenity rather than peace, but I want to give it a similar meaning. And the reason I wanted to use the word serenity, have you ever seen the Seinfeld episode where George Costanza's father, Frank Costanza, discovers the relaxation technique of saying serenity now? Did you ever see that episode? He was having blood pressure issues and his blood pressure going up. And his doctor said to him, whenever your blood pressure starts to rise, you just say serenity now. And you'll calm down and keep your blood pressure in check. By the way, if you want to take away right there and go with that, let me finish the story, because here's what happened. Frank didn't say serenity now, he screamed it. And as his blood pressure went up more, he would scream it louder. But no matter how loud he bellowed and screamed serenity, it didn't happen. He had a friend who was in a mental hospital, and he said to him, serenity now doesn't work. That's what put me in this mental hospital. It's serenity now and insanity later. You better get off of that. How do we find this peace, this serenity, when our blood pressure is going up? I love verse 5 there. It says, and he will be our peace. You know, his birth was announced by the angels in Luke chapter 2. And they said, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace toward men. And even as Jesus was approaching death, what did he say to his disciples? Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. Jesus came to give us peace. He's even referred to as the Prince of Peace. Even if we can't look at our world all around us and see it in peace, we can experience peace through Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, we could even define it more clearly by saying Jesus came to take away the things that destroy our peace. Our burdens and our anxieties, our sins, all of that he wants to take away. The things that make us miserable are the things that Jesus wants to fix. It's what he wants to do. Wants to be your shepherd. But here's the thing about it. It's pretty humbling to think we can't take care of ourselves, to think we're not self-reliant, independent. But that's what the Bible says we need to do. We don't like being compared to sheep. It is not exactly a flattering comparison, if you think about it. Sheep are not industrious. They won't work for you. You can get other animals that are like beasts of burden, and they will work for you. Sheep won't do that. They do not work for you. They won't protect your family. No one has ever gone and got a guard sheep. I mean, seriously, we got crime in our neighborhood. Let's all go get a guard sheep. You know what? We had a guard goose one time, and that goose would chase you out of the yard. It would chase us back in the house if we weren't careful. But nobody goes and gets a guard sheep. Nope, they don't. Also, they're not particularly bright. Okay, get this. You've never seen a sheep in a circus act, have you? I mean, you've seen elephants. You've seen lions. You've seen tigers. You've seen monkeys, chimpanzees. You've seen cats and dogs. You've probably even seen ducks in a circus act. But you'll never see a sheep in a circus act. They just aren't all that bright. So the comparison isn't particularly flattering, is it? But guess what? There's one thing the sheep are very good at, and they do it by instinct, they do it by nature. And you know what that is? They follow the shepherd. Well, at ever knowing a shepherd or anything about it, you bring a shepherd out, the sheep will follow the shepherd. They're good at that. They're good at following, and they're good at trusting. And that's when God refers to us as the sheep of his pasture. The lesson for us is we can be good at trusting God. We can be good at following Jesus. And that's where we get the gifts that Christ has to offer us. And you say, what did I learn from this? Well, Jesus came to be our shepherd, to help us to live each day in his strength, to give us security, and to fill our lives with that peace, to seek and to save the lost. And that's what Christmas is about, is when we learn that Jesus Christ is indeed the great shepherd. And the comparison for us of being sheep, may not be all that flattering, we're not all that comfortable with, but look at the great side of that. The sheep is good at trusting and good at following the shepherd. I could probably stand some improvement in both of those areas, trusting God and following the shepherd. Let me ask you to pray with me, okay? Our God, for each person here, we're so grateful. And we understand that you speak to our lives through the things that happen and through the scriptures and through our friendships and our own experiences. God, I pray that each person here would learn that they're not characterized by their weaknesses and flaws and inconsistencies and the things in their past that seem to drag us all down. We're not characterized by that, but by your strength and by your security and peace that you give us. And so, God, put it in our hearts to be more trusting of you and to understand that we can follow the shepherd and have all the gifts that you come to offer us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
we'll see you Christmas Eve. Amen. We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is at stake. We bow down, we worship Him now. How great, how awesome to see. Together we sing. Everyone sing.